I think I was giving her a bunch of attitude because she wouldn't let me drive. I was just in the car with her, and I didn't want to stop for another night because she didn't want to drive the last 5 hours in the dark.
Yeah, let me drive.
Yeah. And I was upset.
I'm an able-bodied individual.
She spit on me. I'm Jason.
And I'm Jules.
And we doing filmographies. Time for the final John Cazale movie, The Deer Hunter.
Yep.
A Michael Cimino film.
Yeah.
Michael Cimino on top of the world for one movie?
Well, he did that Thunderfoot and...
Oh, he wrote the script for Thunderbolt and Lightfoot. And
Booby Dooby or whatever.
And then they had him direct it.
Yeah, and that put him on the map.
And now?
Made this, and it won an Academy Award.
It's so good. I think it won like 5 for the cast and whatnot.
Mm.
Then he did Days of Heaven, where he went wildly over budget, and the movie's incredibly long, and it sank like a rock, but now it's been reappraised.
Mm.
And people like it.
I don't know what it is.
Oh. It's got Richard Gere. But then all the movies after that are like straight dog shit. Like The Sicilian, The Sun Chaser with Woody Harrelson.
He died, by the way.
Yeah.
So that changes how you feel.
No, I think he had like a serious drug problem. It's amazing. He made it to 60-something, 70?
Yeah, it was like 20...
2006?
2006, yeah.
He made it far for being a bit of a kook.
You made it, kid. So The Deer Hunter, 1978, rated R, 3 hours and 3 minutes long.
Roy Schneider?
Yeah. Tagline? One of the most important and powerful films of all time.
Wow. What a statement, dude.
Isn't it?
Wow.
I don't know about that.
Yeah?
Budget estimated 15 mil.
Oh, yeah, because it was supposed to be 8.5, but he went wildly over. He was through the budget for the film pretty much by the time he got done with the wedding sequences, and he still had like half the movie to make.
Well, they filmed on location everywhere, and there were no sound stages. So I guess we're going Laos or wherever.
Thailand, right?
Did they film in Thailand?
Yeah, Thailand's where they did it, yeah.
It grossed 49 mil worldwide. Yeah, director Michael Cimino. You want to hit us with the synopsis?
That's it? That's all you got? Roy Schneider was going to do the role, and then he walked off, and De Niro took it?
Well, what I got is 3 things, okay? Michael Cimino had convinced Walken to spit in Robert De Niro's face.
Oh, really?
At the end there.
Yeah.
And Bobby D didn't know it was coming. And he was pissed, and he stormed off. But later, Cimino said of that Walken, he's got courage. The slapping and the Russian roulette sequence.
Yeah.
It's real.
Yep.
And they were very upset.
Walken didn't know it was coming. I think De Niro wanted it.
Yes. He basically said to the guy, hey, slap him.
The first guy wouldn't do it, but the second guy was like, yeah, I don't like white people. So
yeah, they hired a guy. He's like, I can't slap Robert De Niro.
No.
And they go, all right, well, you know, you're fired.
Coffee is for closers.
And they heard about some guy who was like, yeah, he hated Americans. So he was like, yes.
Yeah.
I will do just that. We said cut. Nah, I'm not done. And the scene where John Savage is put in the pit and he's yelling, there's rats in here, Michael. That was real. He was yelling at Michael Cimino, there's rats in here. And he kept it.
Another trivia point.
Yeah.
When De Niro is pointing the gun at Cazale's head, there was a real bullet in the gun. He convinced everybody that that's how we had to do it to keep it intense. And Cazale would make sure he would double check the chamber. He was really frightened to make sure that the bullet wasn't going to be in the spot where it was going to kill him.
Right.
And he, of course, was uninsurable. De Niro put the money up because he was dying of cancer at that point.
Yeah, the studio wanted to fire him.
They filmed all of his scenes first.
Meryl Streep said, nuh-uh, I'm walking.
Like Cimino. Chris. They paid, this is De Niro's first movie he got $1 million for.
Okay.
And he's like, good money spent because De Niro brought in all the talent. He brought in Streep and Cazale.
Let me ask you this. Did you buy any of them as Russian? Descendants of first generation Russian immigrants?
I mean, sure, no, but I mean...
Not John Cazale, not Bobby D.
Bobby,
the beard was like...
The beard was the most upsetting part of the movie, that it looks so fake on him the entire movie. I'm sure it's his real beard.
That's what I was thinking. Like, it doesn't look right. It looks like it's real, but it's terrible.
It looks like he glued it on.
It did.
Was it also their other friend, the big beefy
Axel?
Guy? Fucking is that his name? The guy who's not a real actor? He was like a steel foreman?
The guy who says fucking A all the time?
I don't know.
Axel, big guy. Fucking okay, A. Yeah. Fucking A.
Okay.
He gets stuck in the pin.
Oh, yeah. I thought he was going to die.
I did, too.
Because apparently that's really dangerous. People die.
I like the other friend, George Zunda.
Yeah, from No Way Out and No Man's Land.
Boy,
he's got a real good vibe.
So good.
It's like really cheerful. So, Cazale.
He reminds me of Mark Boone Jr. type.
Did I?
In Patriot, specifically.
Okay.
Well, it's not a big thing.
None of the other people went to Nam. It was just the three that we know went to Nam. The other three didn't go. It seemed like Cazale was haunted, and so was the other
dude
that wasn't an actor. I don't.
Or were they drafted?
It
feels like an enlistment.
And didn't they call your numbers?
I mean, they did do that, but I don't know, man. It kind of felt like they all just decided to go.
Bad choice?
Yes.
Didn't work out for them?
No. So going into this movie, I was familiar with the infamous
Russian roulette
scene. Dim Mao?
Is it? I don't know if it's actually Didi Mao.
Didi Mao.
I feel like that's just what I recall.
Is that from Hot Shots Part 2 or something?
Maybe.
The Simpsons.
That scene I'm familiar with. So I'm thinking, yeah, this movie is going to be just full of piss and vinegar war movie. I don't know why they're calling it The Deer Hunter, but fuck it.
Yeah.
And it starts with, did we do the synopsis?
No, okay. I didn't realize you were launching into it.
I mean, what are we going to do here? It's 8 million years long.
I've never seen this movie.
Neither have
I. Never had any interest in seeing this movie.
Oh, me either.
I thought it looked, it seemed like it was going to be boring as fuck.
I don't want to watch a 3-hour war movie.
No. Boy, it's not that.
And not that at all.
Sons of first-generation Russian immigrants, Michael, Robert De Niro, Nick, Christopher Walken, and Stephen, John Savage, are off to Nam, leaving the sleeping Pennsylvania town of Clayton behind for the first time in their young lives. You meant sleepy, maybe?
What did I say?
Sleeping.
Sleeping, yeah.
Before they ship out Stephen, and is set to marry his knocked up, although not by him, girlfriend Angela. Rutanya? Ida. Well, Michael pines for Nick's sort of girlfriend, Linda, Meryl Streep, along with their friends John, George D'Souza, Axel, Chuck Aspergren, and Stan, John Cazale. The trio embark on a deer hunting trip one last time. All of this is only the first 45 minutes or so of the movie. So, yeah, it's a long one.
Yeah. Angela, played by Rutanya Alda.
Okay.
She's the wife of the farmer in Article 99.
Okay.
You remember that guy? Hard guy?
I remember him, but I don't remember his wife.
Yeah, you see her briefly in the beginning.
And I almost don't remember him. Angela in this. Angela's the one that marries the guy that loses his legs.
Steven,
his arm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, the movie starts, and John Cazale, all these guys, are working in a lava factory.
Yeah, how does this work, man? Is it just like you melt that ore into liquid and then you divert the liquid elsewhere over here to make the steel? Is that what that is? It's just fire.
Is it
and
a steel?
They're wearing those fire
I don't know what the fuck
suits.
They're doing. It's like they're preparing for Arnold Schwarzenegger's arrival.
Right. I don't know. It looks hot and horrible.
Yeah, they're wearing like really reflective spacesuits and shit.
Yes.
So they, you know, they get done. It seems like the kind of shift where they work overnight and they're getting done.
Oh yeah, they definitely. Yeah. They get out like 8 a.m.
So they're like, let's go get drunk. So
their friend John,
he runs the pub, right? So they're just knocking him down, getting wasted.
Is this back in the day when it's like not that expensive to open up your own bar and run it? Like
it must
be. You could work at a job for a few years, save some money, and open up a bar?
Yeah, because I mean, he's not the only bar in town because there's another bar up the street we see later when they drive home with the deer. It's lit up. But he seems like he's the local bar.
Mm-hmm.
And it Steven's saying, yeah, I'm getting married today too. And then we're going deer hunting tomorrow. And then
I thought they were going deer hunting first.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God, you guys are going to deer hunt in your tuxes?
Well, yeah. And he goes, y'all going to miss my wedding to deer hunt or whatever? And it's like, no, it's not at all what's going to happen.
He looks like top dollar, does he not?
Yeah, that's what's been bothering me, boys.
He does.
Yeah.
He also reminds me of Dickie Crow.
I'm going to get a picture of that fucking alien.
From Justified?
Yeah.
You know?
Dewey?
Dewey Crow.
Me? That was before I got down here. Ain't you paying attention?
Right?
Yeah. What's his name?
I don't know.
Fucking Spanking the Monkey where he fucks his mom.
Ben Cosgrove.
Why do I know that's not Jeremy? Jeremy something?
Oh, Jeremy Piven?
Nope.
Okay.
Not Jeremy Irons either.
No.
Who that boy from Spanking the Monkey?
Jeremy Davies. Although, Jules meant Damon Harriman.
You ever see that movie?
I did.
Where he's like hanging out with his mom and they just end up fucking?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
She goes, what are you spanking that monkey for? Beat my beaver.
Shit.
You know? So, Chris Walken and De Niro are the true blood friends.
Okay.
The other guys are like, they're friends.
Oh, yeah, I suppose. Because, yeah, Cazale's kind of a dickhead, and the other guy is cool, but he's just there.
Doof, you know.
DeZunda seems like one step removed from the rest of them.
Yeah, somehow. He grew up around them, but, you know, he's not.
He's not part of the steel mill or whatever it is.
Exactly.
The lava factory.
Yeah. And De Niro even says, you know, you're the only guy I go hunting with. One shot. That's all it takes.
You only got one shot.
Yep.
Do not miss this opportunity. It only comes once in a lifetime.
You
got to
lose
Julian.
Yourself.
Right.
You know?
The music.
And the moment.
And you get that spaghetti on your shirt.
Yeah, never let it go.
Nope.
It's so Christopher Walken looks super young in here.
He is he's pretty handsome. Christopher Walken's looking good in this movie.
This is like Christopher Walken I've never seen before.
Right. Correct. Because Christopher Walken pretty much always has a bit of a creepy vibe to him, mm-hmm. or a weird vibe. It's creepy or weird. It is not young and handsome.
No, the first time I'm familiar with him was Pulp Fiction.
I was a good friend of your dad's.
And then everything thereafter. And then he becomes a cultural phenomenon, and it just becomes annoying. But
then before that, I feel like I saw him in The Dead Zone, even though I didn't see the whole movie.
Exactly,
but
I remember.
He's also, I'm a weirdo.
Mm-hmm. I got my hair.
I'm fucking crazy.
So he's looking young. He's looking trim. Robert De Niro's in his 30s. I guess he's supposed to be 19, 20?
Oh, is he?
I don't know.
That shit-ass beard.
How old are those guys?
I don't know.
Right?
Old enough to drink, but I suppose actually you can't even verify that because it's a small town.
Yeah, it's Pennyville. You know?
Oh, before they probably bumped the drinking age up to 21 even.
Pennsylvania changed the drinking age to 21 in 1935.
He looks, you know, like Robert De Niro.
Yeah.
I don't buy him as whatever he's supposed to be, but man, Christopher Walken feels like a child in here.
Yeah.
So
Cazale's got that horrible hair. So he looks like he's about 35.
Yeah, and Axel, I mean, he's just a big guy, so it's hard to say.
Although you've run into those big guys who turns out they're like 18, right?
Yeah, they grow a beard early and they're 9 feet tall, and it's just like, I'm 16. Like, what?
I could rip you in half, but I'm actually real chill.
Yeah, I'm a cool guy. So Steven's getting married, but then Steven, Nick, and Michael are going to NAMM the very next day. I'm not incorrect, right? It's not Steven's child in Angela.
No, you're right. I looked it up because I did not realize that.
Because he goes, I never made it with her.
Yeah. I saw your synopsis. I said, what the fuck? There was things in there that I did not pick up on from the movie. And I immediately started reading about the deer hunter.
Yeah. I don't know whose child it was.
They don't say it.
Because the baby's
specified.
Blonde.
Yeah.
But he goes, I never made it with her, man. Is that, you know, whatever. But John Cazale, he's like, hey, I'll help you fuck her. God damn it, John. That's not cool, man.
He's got some pretty good moments in this movie, dude.
He's good. He's a real prick.
During the wedding, there's like, I found him hysterical at one point. I was like, this guy is awesome.
So the wedding occurs. They're Russian. Their parents are super Russian Orthodox.
I guess.
Angela is getting married to Steven, and Meryl Streep is there. She's with Nick-ish. But boy, Robert De Niro cannot stop staring at her.
I wonder if it's that pressure of going to NAMM. Like, it's really making him realize that she's special.
Maybe.
She's really pretty. Young Meryl Streep. I'm only used to Meryl Streep in like her middle age based on my age.
Mm-hmm.
She's gorgeous. Like she's very much like a very pretty girl next door. I loved her in this. She's really good.
Yeah. I bought it. She's doing a lot of things in here that are very advanced.
Listen, I'm not saying that we break up with Julia Roberts or Parker Posey. But Meryl Streep could also be with us.
We're one man. So, you know.
Yeah. It can just be kissing, ladies.
Don't let the illusion fool you.
It's fine. Can we just kiss you and hold you?
I thought we were going to get a Streep show later on when she gets out of the shower.
Oh, yeah.
But no. So he's all about her. She realizes it, but she's trying to like avoid it.
Yeah. It's a real sad situation where she's like, you're my friend.
Yeah.
And I'll hang out with you. I don't want this.
Because there's a moment where he's, again, just eyeballing her from afar, dancing with Walken, And in the foreground, there's a brunette sitting at a table.
Yeah, she thinks that De Niro's looking at her.
She's giving him the cutie eye.
He is not.
No.
No.
And then later, Walken dances with her. Mm-hmm. And I thought for a split second, because it looked like Meryl Streep was looking around for him, I thought she was going to catch him with her in something. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't happen. So, you know, Robert De Niro almost kisses her, and she's like, whoa, that was...
Yeah, he's trying. She's moving her head around to avoid it.
No, he goes in for the kiss and pulls back, I think, real quick.
But that is, doesn't he try it again like 30 seconds later?
Then I think he does later, yeah. Rolling Rock, it's in cans.
Can I get you a Rolling Rock? Yeah. Can I get you a beer? Yeah. How about a Rolling Rock? Any beer is fine. Rolling Rock's like a Rolling pretty Rock's good beer.
It's an all-American beer.
Yeah, it's premium. It's
what, you know, it's paying this movie. And so the wedding scene is just like balls to the fucking wall, man. They're doing that, hey, foot dance, where they're on the ground and they're footing around and they're lifting people up and everybody's wasted. Christopher Walken does a thing where he's going to jump over a beer and everybody loves it.
That's such a weird little thing, and it's so obviously a tradition.
Yeah, man. And they're charging money to get in so they can give it to the groom and shit. So eventually, Robert De Niro gives them his car to take on their down-the-street honeymoon.
Yeah, what... I find this so weird because, like, they leave.
Yeah.
But then they're back with the group not much later.
So that's just it. They pick the bride and the groom up on their shoulders. Hey, ha-cha-cha-cha-cha. And they're backing them out of the room. And everybody's just standing there applauding. They leave.
Do they just go fuck?
Still standing there applauding.
Do they go fuck? Is that, like, the whole thing? Like, they go have sex to seal the deal?
Everybody's
excited? Like, all the families, all the grandmas and grandfathers just like, put it in.
I don't know, man. You know, there's that moment also where that army guy comes in. What's his deal?
The Green Beret? I think he just came there to drink. Like, that must be a bar you could drink at. Is it a VFW or something?
I guess. He has to go through the dance hall to get to the bar.
I thought he was there to, like, make them go to Nam. And then they get weird about it because they're drunk and they have to go to Nam.
That's what I thought, too.
He's haunted because he's already been there, man. He's De Niro in an hour later in the movie.
Robert De Niro strips off his clothes. He runs around. We see his little wiener.
Is that De Niro running naked?
Yeah.
I must have zoned it. Oh, I don't know.
Because he's running after the car as it drives away. He's running away from the car as they're chasing him. And he takes off his shirt and D'Angelo's like, what are you doing? And he gets butt naked.
Does he have a little penis?
Well, I don't know. It's an admirable sized penis. And Walken comes up, hey, cover your wiener, you know, and he sits down. He goes, hey, man, look, if I die there, you know, don't leave me there.
I don't think he says if I die there. He says, just don't leave me there.
That's the sentiment.
There's quite a few, like, foreshadowing moments where it's like, I have not seen this movie. I have a vague idea of this movie, and there's a couple different things where I'm like, well, that's coming up later.
I really appreciate you said that because
yes,
while they're at the wedding and they put him up on the stage, there's a tradition.
And Steven's like, I hope... I always have these legs and this arm.
Yeah, this specific one.
Yeah.
There's a tradition that they have where they hand them what looks like a candelabra, but there's only two prongs.
Oh, shit. Yeah.
And they have to drink from it together. And if they spill, it's a bad omen.
But if you don't spill, it's good luck for the rest of your life.
Right. And they really do a hard close-up on her spilling.
Just a little drop on her dress.
Two drops.
So... it's her fucking fault?
Yes.
All of this is her fucking fault.
Yeah.
If Steven had not married that knocked up whore, he would have his legs, his arm, Walken would be fine, and De Niro Steven would be scarred for life.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one right there.
I know.
I guess they still would have gone to Nam, and I'm sure it would have gone well.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a sort of nice little harbinger of things to come.
Yeah.
But then they go on the hunting trip, and, you know, boy, they're wearing their tuxes still, some of them.
Fredo forgot his boots.
Not De Niro. Well, he makes a big deal. I bought special boots for this. Ah, fuck. Who took my... Where's my boots?
You always forget your boots. I don't forget my boots. A little bit. Little bit.
Well, let me borrow your extra pair. No, not this time.
No way. I ain't giving them no boots. No more. No more. That's it.
You're a fucking bastard. You know that?
You gotta learn.
I'm done.
You fucking knucklehead. You got rocks in your brain.
You know, and he goes, you see this bullet?
This. This ain't something else. This is this. From now on, you're on your own.
He goes,
hey, you know your trouble, my con? Nobody ever knows what the fuck you're talking about. Huh?
This is this.
What the hell is that supposed to mean? This is this.
You remember that?
No, I do, but I don't remember like the point of it.
He's basically saying like, this is this, right?
This is a bullet.
It is what it is.
The bullet is a bullet.
You are a fucking idiot.
Oh, yeah.
You keep mooching. I'm done. And so they're at a really rinky-dink cabin, and they...
We don't get to see the inside of the cabin, right?
Not till later.
I'm kind of excited by this cabin, this mountain cabin.
I thought later they were going to find Walken living there. He had made his way back.
I thought De Niro was going to live out in the woods for sure.
I did too. I'm like, oh, the deer hunter.
Yeah. He's going to be one of those guys that goes to live in the woods after the hellish nom experience. Mm-hmm. You hear about them.
So him and Walk Dog go out hunting, and he drops the deer with one shot.
One shot.
And they put it on his caddy, and they come careening back into town.
They're wasted. Nobody cares if you drink and drive.
They encourage it. They stop you. Have you been drinking? No. Here's a beer.
Mm-hmm.
And they go to the bar, and they're kind of, you know, carousing around and jovial. And then Zunda starts playing a funeral dirge. Really kills the buzz. And everybody's like, oh, yeah, shit. We're going to Vietnam tomorrow.
Hands, touching hands. Mm-hmm. Isn't that a song?
Hands, finger, knees and toes, knees and toes. Remember that one?
Sweet Caroline.
Deer Hunter.
Shit, do we just do a hard cut right here to Nam?
Yeah.
I knew this was coming.
Mm-hmm.
I was not looking forward to the Nam section. I thought it was going to be super lame. This fucking movie gets right to it, dude. They set you up with all that wedding shit. You get to know everybody.
Yeah.
Immediately, they're fucking captured. This movie is expertly crafted.
Well, so here's the deal. We hear the helicopters. We see them descending upon a village and just napalming the fuck out of it.
De Niro's all fucked up.
He's laying on the ground. Yep. On a couple of other GI corpses.
And they immediately, the North Viet?
Mm-hmm. Viet Cong.
Yeah, the Viet Cong. Grenades. Young people in a bunker.
Yeah, they're hiding out, women, children.
It's horrible.
Just grenades the shit out of them.
The lady comes out, partially on
blows
fire.
Her away.
She's holding a baby. I was not ready for this. And then, to be honest, I did not think that I was going to be seeing babies get executed. It was a little rough.
De Niro breaks out a flamethrower and char broils that fucker.
Can't save that lady, but hey, this guy should burn to death for what he's done.
And then he shoots him after he burns him.
Maybe just let him burn. Why put him out of
his misery? Helicopter comes in, Steven's on it, Walken's on it, and I'm like,
pretty unbelievable that you guys would.
They're in the same squad, huh?
Yeah. Well, yeah. And then they're like, hey, De Niro. And he's like, he's not even seeing him.
No. And then an explosion occurs, and they look, and it's just a flood of
dudes. A wall of them. Sharp cut to they're captured.
They're in waist-high water.
In fucking 5 minutes, they're captured. We didn't even get, like, the crazy Vietnam storyline. It's amazing. No. I'm really impressed with how quickly they went to being prisoners of war.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, oh, wow. So the rest of this movie is like a survival movie?
I knew this was going to be split into three parts.
Because we're about an hour in at this point. And so they're in waist-high water, in a prison, under a shack, that they keep fishing guys out and forcing them to play
Russian roulette, yeah.
Yeah, and they slapping the shit out of guys, you know. They're betting on it.
And I might come smoke! And I might come smoke!
So Steven's losing his asshole.
Oh, yeah. He can't handle it. Every time the gun goes off, he's freaked out.
Yeah.
Well, because he knows for whom the bell tolls.
Exactly.
It tolls for thee.
Time marches on.
It's coming. It's going to be your turn soon, buddy.
Yeah, so Bobby D goes over. He's like, hey, man, just nuzzle against me.
Yeah.
You know, take your mind off of it.
Think about your girl.
Think about it.
Think about that baby in her that's not yours.
Think about it. It's mine. And he's just like, all right, man, I think I'm good. And they pull him up, and Robert De Niro's up there, and they're slapping the shit out of him. And he does it. He's with Stevie. And he goes, Stevie, you got to do it. You got to be a man. Oh, I can't do it, Bobby D. And he doesn't. He almost does it, but he doesn't, and the bullet grazes the side of his head.
Yeah, this little scraping groove, so he's bleeding, he's squirting blood, but he would have blown his brains out.
Oh, absolutely. So they throw him in the pit full of rats.
That's what happens when you don't play the game, you go in the pit.
Yep.
The pit is bad.
It's all about the game and how you play it.
If you go in the pit, you die, Stevie.
Yeah.
Because the pit is like a bamboo thing where you're 95% underwater.
In water, yeah. And there's rats.
Yeah. And I think you die because the water goes up and kills you.
Eventually, I think you just can't support yourself. Yeah. Either it's high tide or you just can't do it. And the rats are nipping on your nuts. And
before you even know what's happening, when they first transition to this part of the movie, you see one of the guys kicking and stomping on that cage.
Yeah.
And you kind of know it's a cage, but you don't quite realize what's up.
Yeah.
Looks like a crab catcher. Catching crabs. This is where I store my crabs after I catch them.
Well, they're crabby.
Yeah.
So he gets back down there. Robert De Niro does, and he goes, "Hey, Stevie's gone. He's done for." What the fuck? What are you talking about? He's right over there. Nah, forget about him.
Forget about him. He's fucking done, dude. Once you go in there, you're done.
You and me got to get out of here. All right. In order to do that, we're gonna have to do a face off where they take my face off. And
I fuck somebody else's wife.
Here's the deal, though. We're gonna have to play D.D. Mao with three bullets.
I'm going to talk him into doing three bullets.
Three bullets.
With the extra crazy Americans.
I'm going to shoot three guys, and you're going to grab that other guy's gun. And he's like, okay. Christopher Walken goes, lives. Robert De Niro goes. No, Robert De Niro goes first. He lives.
Yeah. He's fucking fearless. He's
Christopher
crazy.
Walken goes, he lives. They give the gun back to De Niro. He shoots the guy that's been slapping him. Shoots another guy. Walken grabs a gun. Guns are flying everywhere and shit.
Walken gets blasted in the leg.
He gets shot in the leg as he's bludgeoning a guy in the face.
They're very angry. I like how much anger they have.
Yeah. He goes, let's get out of here. He goes, nah, I got to go bludgeon that guy over there now. we should probably go.
We gotta get our buddy out. Yep. And then we're going to float down this log.
Yeah. So there's a fallen tree. They get Steven out. He's,
crazy. Clamped.
Yeah.
Man, Steven's fucking weak as hell.
I would have left him.
Yeah?
Yep. I would have looked at his face and I would have been like, you know what this is.
God damn, Jules, it's ruthless.
Yep. I would have peed on him too.
I thought De Niro was going to have to kill him when they were floating down the river.
I thought he was going to have to eat him or something later. Yeah.
Well, I thought he was just going to pinch his nose and mouth shut and kill him that way because he was screaming.
Right. He's like, shut the fuck up. So they're floating and instantaneously helicopters come by.
I mean, possibly they're in a pretty heavy war area.
Yeah, but it looked like there were guys hanging off of it.
They were.
Like bad guys, right?
Oh.
Ah, and get off my helicopter. So they circle back and they pick him up and Walken goes in. Stevie and Bobby D are hanging off the side.
And Walken's forgetting, hey, those are my friends.
Pull them up.
Yeah.
I'd say on my watch.
It's in my ass right now.
It's appropriate because we're in NAM. and Robert De Niro and Steven fall into the water. And Stevie's like, oh, Bobby D, I busted my leg.
Well, Steven falls first and De Niro drops.
De Niro goes
to
after
help him. Yeah.
Yeah. And he goes, I fucked up my leg and my arm.
Broke them both.
Yeah.
And the arm?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Bobby.
Why? Hit the water.
I fell on rocks, he says.
Oh.
Bobby D picks him up and carries him for an untold amount of distance.
I'm sure quite a bit, yeah.
A few kessels at least, if not parsecs.
Yeah. How many parsecs is that dick? I imagine that those wounds are quite festering from being in the dirty water.
Yeah, there's leeches.
Being carried on dirt roads for a day or two.
Who knows, right?
They eventually show you that leg and it's like the bones are separated.
Do they?
Well, they show the ankle, the bones are out.
Do they?
Yeah.
Oh. So eventually, Bobby D gets to a procession of people fleeing refugees.
Yep.
And some South Vietnamese soldiers.
Is that what's up?
Yeah, because the guys he flags down are not American.
He tosses them in the back of one of the trucks. He's like, don't fuck them.
No, actually, he puts them on the hood. He goes,
don't fuck him.
Mm-hmm.
He can't fight you now, but he'll come back.
Later.
A little bit.
And then we just see Bobby D walking. And I'm thinking, okay, he's about to, now the movie's going to shift, and he's just going to be surviving, hunting deer.
Like in Vietnam?
Yeah. That's what I thought.
You think he's going to leave the procession to safety and be like, I'm in the woods now.
I think he's just going to march along and then just get lost in the crowd, and then he's just there. He's a Colonel Klotz.
He's going to be Sisu?
Uh-huh.
God, you got to see that movie Sisu, dude.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Steve Sisu.
Nah, man. He's just like, there's a great moment when the Nazis are like, they find out from their leaders. They're like, this guy, he's killed a bunch of our men. And they're like, oh, that guy? You need to get out of there right now. Why? Well, the Russians murdered his whole family, and he was so unhinged in the army.
They gave up trying to discipline or control him. They just sent him out alone into the wilderness to hunt Russian patrols.
Oh, you guys that are alone by yourselves, you 12 Nazis, and this guy's just out and around you somewhere? He's going to get you all. It's fucking great. Oh, it's so good. You got to see a movie. It's wonderful.
Yeah, maybe I will.
Oh, no, you won't, because I suggested it.
Because you suggested it. So, Walken ends up at an American base, camp, hospital.
Wildly traumatized.
Yeah. We see him looking at his wallet, and he's got a picture of Meryl Streep, but it's not the same wallet that Robert De Niro's looking at with the picture of Meryl Streep.
You know, they just both have pictures of her?
They could. Otherwise, I thought maybe he somehow ended up with Nick's wallet.
I don't know.
I don't know when that would have been. So they're like, hey, are you a Russian? I'm American. You know, what's your mama's name? Ah, I'm weeping now.
I can't remember. Laura?
So this is wild, man. Then he's just let loose on the streets of Saigon or whatever.
Well, I mean, I think...
Like he's just waiting to be shipped out.
Yeah, he's getting treatment. I mean, I think that's what happens.
But then you're just... Isn't that wild? Like, you go to war, you survive war, some pretty harsh shit.
They're just going to send you back out there?
And now you're just hanging out, waiting to go.
Yeah.
Right? Because he's just down in downtown and just... Ooh, Suki, pee-pee and my wee-wee. And
that shit made me real sad when that sex worker's like, hey, come back here.
No.
And there's the hooker. Fucking... Sex worker's got that little baby.
Yeah.
He's like three or two probably.
Yeah.
Just watching.
No! Can't stay in a room with a kid crying. Come on! No.
Grab your panty butt! Fuck you!
She's got to make that money. It's a bad situation over there. It would be nice if maybe she put up a fucking curtain.
You know what would be nice? See? If she found fucking God. Oh. Got her act together.
Hell yeah.
Pulled herself up by the bootstraps.
You, me. Let's bring God, Jesus Christ, yep. to the Vietnamese.
Let's make Vietnamese America again. So now he's just out wandering, and he's hearing gunshots in rapid succession that don't make sense for the game. But he goes, oh, what the hell's going on over there?
Maybe it's a super tournament.
Maybe there's multiple.
Yeah.
And it's dead bodies. What the hell?
Yeah, when this shows dead bodies, it's like, oh, did they... find some evil Viet Cong?
Yeah.
They're just like, they get them?
Retaliation killings. Oh. They all have red headbands on, though. So all of a sudden, this like French guy sitting in a Porsche.
I cannot play this kind of game myself, but I'm always, how do you say, looking out for those things quite different.
He goes, I don't want any of your shit.
But you must come in.
Yeah, I'll come with you.
I see you have your penis hard from the gunshot.
So he just goes with him inside.
Because his penis is hard from the gunshot.
Was it?
No.
Come on, Jason. Yours was.
Yeah.
And there's dudes in there, you know, doing me mao. And there's a guy holding court. He's got on a pair of glasses, and one of the lenses is the sunglasses.
This fucking guy, I feel like, is the thing they lampoon in the parodies of this.
Yeah. Guy? Now, my subtitles at this point indicates that they're speaking Chinese.
Shit. Do you have subtitles? Do you know what these people are saying in this movie?
No. But it just indicates that they're speaking Chinese.
Okay. That doesn't make sense.
So I'm like, why is there a Chinese Russian roulette club in Saigon? Is it supposed to be Saigon?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I know later.
Saigon.
Goes to Saigon during the fall of Saigon.
Shit.
But I guess I wasn't clear. I assumed it was.
Isn't Saigon the safe space in the Nam zone?
If you could call it safe.
There's a Playboy bar in the background.
Ah, very good.
Yeah. And so Walken's like, oh, this is interesting. And Bobby D's are like, oh, I know that guy.
Shit, my guy.
It's like Nick. Bobby D's just hanging.
You know? I mean, this is what they have to do, maybe?
I guess.
they're all fucking jaded from the hellscape that they're in. They're like, yeah, I'm in Russian roulette. I'll have a beer and watch people blow their brains out.
So that's what I thought was going to happen. He's just going to be on this weird thing now. So something occurs, and everybody starts to flee. And Walken ends up in the Porsche with the Frenchman.
Something happens?
What happens?
Walken loses his fucking mind when he realizes what's happening. And he goes over there and he like grabs the gun and he like dry fires on the one guy. That's there's right. no bullet. And then he puts the gun to his head and pulls the trigger.
That's right.
Everybody flips the fuck out and they're chasing Walken out. He's fighting people.
That's right. De Niro's he punches like, that guy in the
that's my friend.
In the nuts.
So Walken's just straight up running down the street and then the guy drives up. He's like,
hey, get in.
Is your dick still hot? Now, the gunshots?
Bobby D's running after them.
Nick. Yeah. Nick, hey.
And
my friend.
He's. Walken's looking directly at him.
Somebody say my name.
What's that? Hey, can you get out of the way, Bobby D? I thought I heard somebody that I recognize. And they're gone.
Yeah.
So Bobby D heads back home and they're throwing a big welcome. Earlier in the movie, Walken and Bobby D live together in a double wide.
Oh, yeah. We skipped over Streepy.
And Streepy is like, hey, can I live here while you're gone?
Because my fucking dad comes beating in drunk and he just beats me up. I got to go to this wedding.
Yeah.
I'm wearing the wedding dress. And my dad's beaten. Hitting me in the face because he hates women.
Because he doesn't recognize me.
Give them all flat tires.
Did you know that this role was a nothing until they brought her in?
No.
And they're like, just write your own dialogue.
Yeah.
It was a complete nothing part. She just wanted to be there to keep an eye on Cazale.
Oh, sorry. When they were at the wedding, John Cazale punches a woman in the face.
Oh, my God. We skipped over that. It's fucking amazing.
Isn't it?
The
singer guy.
Yeah.
Who like, also runs the store.
He's like the announcer. And
he goes, hey, can I cut in?
With Cazale's girlfriend.
Yeah.
And he's just like massaging her butthole vagina area.
Yeah.
And Cazale's like,
get a hand on her ass.
It's only a wedding, Stanley.
What do you mean it's only a wedding? Guy, look, he did it again. He just did it. Come on, I gotta go get my gun out of my coat.
Get your gun. Go get it.
What the fuck's going on?
Axel's like, what?
Do you see what this guy's doing?
Yeah, whatever, man.
This is crazy. And he's got whatever. The craziest look on his face. It's hilarious.
It is.
He is hilarious as this drunk. And he completely ruins it by punching his girlfriend
in the face.
He
just walks over and punches her in the face.
Knocks her out.
Cold. And everybody's like, and they're wrestling and falling around. And then she gets back weird. Up. She goes, you punched me in the face. And he goes, oh, does it hurt? Let me kiss it. And she goes, oh, yeah, I love you.
Why the fuck would he punch her and
I don't
not
know.
The other guy? The guy
but it
doing-
was a real way of the gun moment.
Shut that mouth or I'll come over there and start her head.
It's so crazy that he punches her, though.
It is, but
he's so fucking
I normally
funny.
Don't get behind that sort of thing. Violence towards anybody.
Yeah.
Jason, but specifically women.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to put this back on.
I know what you're doing now. It took me a second.
But boy, I like that scene. So weird.
When he hits her or
yeah,
before that?
Because she gets up and she's just like, oh, you punched me. And
it's the 70s. This is how we react. Yeah, I was out of line letting that guy molest me.
And yeah.
I mean, she is a little out of line letting him go do that, but
well,
Jesus Christ.
It's yeah, bad, but it also kind of seems well, like whatever.
Yeah.
You know, it's.
They're drunk. It's a fucking thing. If anybody is.
He's
a dick,
ladies
it's
man,
that guy.
As we find out. So it's not like he's not moving on to the next broad.
The fucking butcher guy?
Cazale.
Oh.
He's always talking about banging
on. Oh, yeah.
On
he's
Darla's
crushing all sorts of
right.
puss when he comes. I thought he came back from Nom and he was
no,
getting lots of
he's
pussy.
He's been there
it.
The whole time.
Everybody else is in Nom and he's like, hey, I hear there's no guys here.
Yeah.
Well, guess who's got a little dick? It's me.
That's why I didn't go to Nam.
Yeah, little dick syndrome.
Yeah, Zundman couldn't go because he's got bad knees.
Yeah, from being overweight. Fuck.
Yeah,
take it out.
He's not that much bigger than
who.
Anyways, so
he's very round. Are you? I don't know anybody else that's round.
Yeah, no, I don't either.
Am I? It looks like him.
So. They're having a big party for him, but he doesn't go.
Oh, goes, Michael?
Yeah,
he's
he
back.
Goes, hey, keep driving.
Well, fuck yeah. Why would he want to go to a party and act normal
yeah,
after
right?
being through all that shit?
Right. He's dressed like fucking Guile and M. Bison at the same time.
That shit's ridiculous. I can't believe he wears that fucking getup. But,
who are you, the guy in the wheelchair from Article 99? Get the fuck out of here.
I'm absolutely on his side for not wanting to go to this party. I mean... the amount of life and death and horror he's been through, who would want to go back to their old life?
Like, I get it.
Hey, what's up, guys? Yeah, let's have a beer.
They're excited because Michael's back.
Yeah.
But they don't know that Michael's been playing Dim Dim Mao.
Michael's a completely different person, man.
Michael ain't fucking around.
Michael ain't coming back.
He wasn't fucking around before, to be fair, but yeah. He's seriously not fucking around now, man.
By his not fucking around before, that personality he had is why he's the person who's most set to be able to live past all that he's been through.
Absolutely.
He was already a fucking loner with principles, and he was able to power through it all.
He's so badass, as the movie goes on, too.
I like him a lot. I can't handle that beer, but I like the guy.
Yeah, so he goes to stay in a hotel across the river, looking at the lava factory. And then eventually he goes back the next day and sees everybody's just now leaving. And Meryl Streep's out there, and he's hiding behind a billboard. And he goes down to their house, and he's knocking on the door. They're double wide.
Come in.
Door's open. She's weeping. He knocks again. She gets on her sweater and goes in. Oh, Michael. Oh, my God. Hey, what's up, Toots?
You missed your party.
Yeah, everybody was going to be so pissed that you're not. He missed you. And
I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah. You're looking good, though. Oh, thanks.
You want a kiss?
Yeah. Come on into your house. And well, I got to go to work. You know,
can
she made a sweater for Nick, but it's too big. She puts it up against him.
Oh, it's perfect for you.
And it gets snagged on his wall of medals.
Nick never called me. Have you seen him?
Maybe you were out when he called you.
According to Wikipedia, he proposed to me during this movie earlier on.
He did.
Yeah.
But
it's kind of a lock.
I think he walked it back. Remind me.
Nick.
You would?
What I mean is if we get back to you. When we get back.
I mean, when else? I mean, obviously, when he gets back, he's leaving tomorrow.
Yeah. Or, well, marry me right now, motherfucker. So, you know, Mike's like, hey, how about I walk you? And she goes, oh, okay, you're a gentleman or whatever. And she's really gripping his arm.
It's interesting because she's like, Walken has abandoned her.
Mm-hmm.
She loves him, but he's gone. And then De Niro is sweet and showing interest in her, but not like coming at her hard.
No.
Like he was before he went away.
Right.
He's more supportive. I don't know. He's got a very pleasant vibe to his courting.
He's grown.
Yeah.
He's a man. Mm-hmm. You know, he's very cordial, polite.
It's like he's saying, I could be here for you.
Exactly. He even says, like, look, I know you love Nick. You know, he's gone. I don't know what that's all about or whatever. And I just want you to know, like, I get what you're feeling or whatever. And she goes, well, why don't you come into the store? You know, and this older lady that works here just starts mauling on him.
She's kissing him. Oh, my God, you're here.
Oh, Michael. Blah, blah, blah,
blah. Michael, I didn't know you were coming back.
And then that other lady who was looking at him at the party, she works there, too.
It's like, hey.
She goes, oh, hey, Michael.
And then fucking sloppy bitch comes over and he's like, hey, I know I was molesting some girls, but good to see you.
Mm, yeah, here's a cigar.
I know.
You're gonna go far.
Yeah, it's weird when he gives him the cigar.
Mm-hmm. He's a real paisan.
You know, De Niro's like, I don't want any attention, but then he's wearing that fucking getup.
Good Lord. He's got his never takes it off. On, his fucking Tolstoy beard.
What's up with that? I guess it's just like a pride thing? Like, you worked real hard to get that?
I mean, I think there's a certain... What that? I don't know if you'd get that from Vietnam. Like, there's a certain level of that, like Kevin Costner. Like, that's his new nice clothes.
Well, but he, I don't know. He seemed kind of decorated by the time they bump into him before they get captured. Like, he seems, isn't he like a Green Beret or something?
I don't know, man. They're joining the airborne whatever.
We're going airborne. So
I hope they sent us where the bullets are flying.
That's right.
And then he wipes out that village basically single-handedly.
So maybe he's not rolling with them.
No, he's not part of their team.
Okay, he's just like a hit guy. He's dropped in. He's pretending he's dead, and he's lighting the guy on fire. Whatever it is. And so, see you later, or whatever. And she's like, yeah, at home. Yeah, at home. Because she's living in this home.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they're sort of developing a little bit.
And it's just, it's weird because of Nick. Missing yes. Nick. But it's slowly erasing Nick a little bit.
He eventually does go to see John Cazale and Axel.
I thought those guys were haunted by being in the war too, but no, they're haunted from seeing Steven.
No, because they haven't even seen Steven.
They know about him though.
John Cazale. No, they don't.
Yeah, they're the ones that are like, no, he's back.
No, is
it? He's back, bro. Yeah, they're the ones that reveal he's back, and then he goes to go see the wife.
I thought it was Meryl Streep.
No.
Okay.
They look so haunted, like they've grown a lot since he's been gone. It's been like 2 years?
Yeah. Probably.
I got a mustache.
He goes, hey, you got a mustache now.
Check it out. Yeah. I got no hair.
I got this gun, too. He's like, oh, Jesus, with the gun over here.
Yeah.
So then he goes to see Angela, who's near catatonic.
Yep.
Playing with clocks.
It's got the little living blonde with baby.
Steven's mother.
Uh-huh.
And he goes, where's Steven, Angela? Where is he, you know? Yeah. No. Seriously, where is he, though?
Fucking tell me.
Here's a phone number.
763-634-1897.
He calls it and nothing. And then we see Steven is in a VA hospital. He's got no legs.
That effect of him not having legs is quite bizarre.
You think they were in that white box?
I mean, obviously. He's
crammed
like,
in there?
Yeah. The way he's sitting? Is that what you would even describe it as?
Yeah.
The way his back part is so rigidly standing up.
That yeah, it's not. It's yeah. Like,
that's not you.
And then he's got a bum arm, too.
I didn't know about the arm until I read the Wikipedia.
Yeah, he's playing bingo, and eventually Michael gets through on the phone. Oh, hey, Mike. Oh, yeah, man, I'm living in a resort. Shit's baller, you know? Really? What's that sound? Ah, it's my wheelchair, you know. Ah, I got to get out of here. See you later. What? Oh, I got to go, Michael.
Zoom, zoom.
Later, man. So Michael's just like, this isn't right. And he goes down there.
I'm living my life a quarter mile at a time, Michael. I'm just zipping all over this place.
And he gets down there and he goes, oh, hey, Mike, what the fuck, man?
I don't got friends.
Told you
I got
to family. Come down here, you know. Angela didn't send you. He's like, what? No, man. And it's legit. He legit wants Steven in his life.
Yeah.
You know, and he's, come on, we're going to go, oh, man, what? Nah. Well, hang on. Let me show you this.
I mean, him, Steven, and Nick are like, they went through the worst situation together. Yeah.
And he got him out.
We're married now.
You know?
We're friend married.
And so he shows him his drawer full of money. He goes, I don't know, man. I just keep getting all this money from Saigon.
It's crazy.
No, nothing. I don't know what it's for. And he goes, it's fucking Nick. How do you know, though? Well, because, you know, it's part of the plot of the movie. So he's like, oh, we're going to get out of here. He goes, nah, man, leave me alone. And he takes him with him. In the process of bringing Steven back into the fold, apparently Angela also gets better and comes to hang out with him quite a bit.
Yeah, they build robot legs for him and a robot arm.
Meryl Streep comes home one night, and she's all like, hey, I'm going to make dinner. And De Niro's like, ah, I can't be here. And she goes, well, let's just go to bed.
Go to bed with me?
I feel like I'm too far away from here or whatever. He storms out. She goes with him, and they go to his motel. And we see her getting out of the shower.
Looking nice.
Putting on a towel.
It's getting pretty hot.
Right, and she goes out.
I'm into it.
Talking like, hey, my butt's lube. And De Niro's asleep, though.
Is he?
Yeah.
I don't know that he's asleep.
He's asleep on top of the bed.
His eyes are not open?
No.
I thought he was just kind of catatonic in his non-world. I think
he's asleep.
Okay.
She crawls into bed under the covers in her towel still, which is presumably wet.
Damp. Moist?
Even still, now your bed's all moist and damp.
Yeah.
And not in a good way.
Like with mold?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, they're dating-ish, and he watches her bowl. Axel gets stuck under the ball-changing thing. Where's my fucking ball? And he runs and slides under the pins.
Man, De Niro's got a problem, but he's a sweetheart.
Yeah.
He is sweet to her.
Yeah. You know, considering
all that he's going through, he's there. He's watching her bowl. He's sweet. He smiles at her. He's there for her.
Yeah.
I like it.
And I think then they go deer hunting again. Cazale, Zunda, Axel, and Bobby D. And they're all running around just shooting nuts and bolts. And Cazale hits a deer, doesn't kill it in one shot, though. Bobby D's about to kill a deer, and he just shoots his gun in the air. Oh, he's shooting his guns in the air.
Like a Rambo?
Yeah. And the deer's like, oh, thanks, bro. And he runs away. And then John, Bobby D goes to the waterfall and he's just yelling. They stick to the rivers and the lakes that you're used to. And then he gets back to the cabin and John Cazale's in there with Axel. And they're bullshitting each other with John Cazale's gun. And he points it at Axel. He goes, oh, you dirty rat.
No.
You know, make my day.
No.
I'm a pussy. Don't make fun of me.
Yippee-ki-yay.
And Robert De Niro comes in and he sees this and he just snatches that gun out of his hand. And he's like, you dumb motherfucker. You think you're bad? And he pulls out the bullets and puts one in. I'm bad. And he puts the gun to his head and
No.
At first, blows him away.
Because I was like, what? There's no bullets in there. De Niro shoots the roof. There's bullets in there. And he's like, you fuck.
I mean, no bullets other than that one.
No, it's completely loaded. Then De Niro knocks him out and
knocks fucking all the bullets out. And then he puts it to his brain, puts one in and puts it to his head.
Let's
eat. Kills him.
Swallow a bullet. Do a shot. We're gonna
fire it up.
Fire it up.
We're gonna go bang up, darling.
It's your shooters. Get your guns away, huh, guys?
And I mean, boy, that is a traumatizing sequence.
When he puts that gun in his face?
And pulls the trigger.
Yeah, every time they pull the trigger on somebody in this, it's like, oh, God.
Yeah, you know he pooped. He pooped and then sucked the poop back into himself. It was so traumatic. And, you know, they get back and Bobby D is just out and they're just like, oh, boy, I'm traumatized. So he's like, you know what? I got to go to Saigon. And he does. He gets in there. And it's the fall of Saigon, man. There's people trying to get into the embassy. He does. There is a guy kicking a guy.
Okay.
At the gate. And
Because people are trying to get through.
Yeah, they're throwing their
luggage. It's amazing they're not just killing everybody.
Especially the guards that are on the opposite side of the fence who are in the crowd. And I think there is actually a shot that's fired at a person. So Bobby D, he's just rolling in the deep. And he finds Senor Frenchy Pants.
Senor Frenchy Pants.
Yeah. Oh, hey, fucker, I want to go to that roulette shit. And he goes, oh, I don't do that anymore. And he goes, well, here's hundreds of thousands of dollars.
I don't think that's it. How much do you think it was?
Honestly, it was probably like $2,000 or $3,000.
Yeah, he's got a fat wad.
Just that he lays on his car.
Yeah.
To get into the game, I'm betting it's probably close to $10,000 or $15,000.
No, I think they save some numbers, don't they? I don't think it's that.
I don't.
Up there.
Well, no, because he goes, it's $1,000 to get in.
You say we have to pay for going inside.
How much?
$1,000.
And then he goes.
You say, yes, the famous American is inside. You have to give him $500 more for this information.
And then when he goes back to see those dudes, and he fucking fans the money. And the guy's like, nah. And then he fucking puts a watch on it, too, or something. Maybe the guy's billfold. And he goes, yes, this is what I wanted. I love it. So he gets there and they're doing the shooting stuff and he eventually gets into the game and Walken comes out with his red bandana on, looking just pallid.
Ready to go.
He's ret to die.
Yeah. Kill me.
Bobby D starts shaking on him like, what the fuck, man? Where you been at? It's me, Bobby D, Nicky boy. And he goes, I don't know you.
Yeah, in the Wikipedia, not your synopsis, right? Isn't it like they say Walken doesn't recognize him?
Mm-hmm.
He recognizes him.
I don't.
He knows who he is.
He might be playing it off, but he doesn't admit it. And
he doesn't care. He's on a mission.
He spits in Bobby D's face.
Yeah.
At this point, he goes off, and Bobby D's like, "That's when he goes, get me in the game. Put me in, coach. I'm ready to play."
I don't think De Niro knew he was going to spit on him. Did you say that?
I did.
Okay.
And he was quite upset.
It's a fat wad, right?
Yeah, it's the biggest in the world. So they're playing the thing, and then all of a sudden the guy comes in like, hey, record scratch. Bobby D's jumping in.
I guess you're wondering how I got here.
And so Bobby D sits down, and he's all like, hey, man, what the fuck? What are you doing, man? Talk to me.
Doesn't he see his like veins?
He looks at his arm and he's just got track records for days.
I don't think they're track marks though. Aren't his veins just like weird and brown?
I mean, it's like they're scabby, but I'm assuming it's like a train wreck going on.
Yeah, he's supposed to be a hardcore heroin addict now.
Seemingly winning countless numbers of these rounds.
I think he's just been the Walking Dead since that day.
Apparently, but I guess he's also been winning just a shit ton of these things.
Because he's fearless. He doesn't give a fuck.
Well, yeah, but
I'm happy
fearless
die.
Doesn't equate to invincible.
Yeah.
You know, it's a pretty high probability you're going to get shot.
Luck of the Irish, Russian.
Yeah. Yeah. So Bobby D looks him in the eyes and he goes, is this what you want, man? Puts the gun to his melon and he goes, I fucking love you, Nick. Pulls the trigger. Nothing. Christopher Walken, he goes, one shot. He goes, yeah, one shot, Nicky, one shot.
It's an amazing scene, dude, because you know it's coming.
Yeah.
But it's so fast, it's so bloody, and like quick. It's really good.
And then I guess he gets his body shipped.
I know, I was thinking about that too. He's like, well, I know Saigon's falling and everything is a hellscape, yeah, but bringing my buddy who's pumping blood out with me.
Like, clearly he didn't go back to the base and then get somebody to come get him, because they had to travel via boat.
Do you think he strapped him to his back and then just flew?
I don't know, man. They must have.
Like Billy Crudup, yeah, World Traveler.
Yeah, they must have, because he drops him off at the place. The army guys do, Robert De Niro. But then he has to pay that French guy and they have to take a boat. So he's like somewhere. Mm-hmm. And I guess he just puts him on his back and walks him.
I've done before. I'm going to do it again.
So they ship the body home. And they have a Russian funeral. Yep. And they all go back to the bar for breakfast. Coffee's already on. Johnny Boy's making eggs. De Niro and Streep are not at all sure how to handle what's happened and what that means for them. Can't even really look at each other.
And they're like, we need to eat his body.
Yes.
So he's with us.
We need to eat his placenta. Mm-hmm. Pate. So Johnny Boy's making eggs and he's humming God Bless America. Comes out and he's like, oh, sorry. And Meryl Streep starts singing God Bless America.
Well, nobody in the boys who was living very long. Ask my teacher why folks die. She says some folks they die for so long.
And they all sing. And the movie ends.
Jules?
Yeah.
I don't think we have the same opinion of this movie.
Oh, absolutely not. I knew we wouldn't.
Jules?
Yeah. You loved it.
I loved it so much.
You're going to give it a 10, aren't you?
I'm going to give it a 9.
Yeah. I, for the most part, like the movie. It felt like your kind of a movie where it's just a bunch of young people hanging around, you know?
Why is that my kind of movie?
You like those movies.
Well, how do you know that?
Because you say it.
But what?
All the movies.
What movies?
Love and Other Catastrophes.
No, I said I like that genre.
Yeah.
Okay. Listen, I'm not saying I this movie did not have me from
you gave it a 9?
I gave it a 9.
Okay.
But that's like, I'm not saying it's a 9 for everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying my personal experience, having never seen this movie and being a little bit into the first hour where they're just fucking around with the wedding, I'm like, I like this. I'm not super into it, but I like it.
Yeah.
To being super fucking fucked up the second they got to Nam, I was scared. I was anxious.
Oh, wow.
It was fucking me up. That whole, the whole Russian roulette thing where they're down there in the cages, it was so intense. It was fucking me. I was scared.
See, yeah. That's
I was not expecting it. We went from wedding to, like, knowing it's coming, but not realizing that they were immediately going to be captured. I was fucking, it fucked me up, and the rest of the movie worked wonderfully from that point on.
Oh, interesting.
The first hour, not so much. I laid the groundwork. Like, it made me get to know them a little bit. But really, it's the last two thirds that I was like, holy shit, I'm in it to win it.
I mean, I'll give this movie a 7.
Okay.
I think.
I think my favorite thing of this movie is probably drunk Cazale. What's he doing?
Yeah,
there?
That was a really good line delivery.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Double nines.
Wow.
Yeah. He had the most to do in this out of everything. I feel like he had the most chance to do something interesting.
I was definitely glad that he showed back up.
He showed back up. I think, like, he showed back up, like backup cops, because backup team. No, he showed back up later
showed,
on.
Came back.
Yes, he done came back.
So I was like, oh man, that's probably all I'm going to see of him. Because I assumed the rest of the movie was going to be them and Nam surviving.
Yeah.
But that, yeah, he comes back. I'm like, oh, cool. I give him another 7.
Okay. Yeah. Double 7. Double 7. Double 9s. Fuck y'all. I really liked the Deer Hunter.
He did. He's watching it again right now, folks.
I am. Jesus' son and Deer Hunter are playing side by side.
He's mashed them together.
Okay, so listen, we're going to go ahead and give him the spiel, mm-hmm. and then we're going to reveal what comes after this.
Okay.
You can find us on?
YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, Reddit. We doing filmographies.
Goddamn right.
Gmail us at we doing filmographies at yahoo.com.
Oh, shit. Yahoo!
You can call us at 763-634-1897.
We've been speaking with a lot of confidence about that number tonight.
And now and
it's possible it. It is wrong.
Absolutely.
Contact us. Let us know what you think.
Give us a review on something. Let us entertain someone you know.
Meryl? Mm-hmm. Meryl? Do you want to call us? You don't want to call us. Okay. Y'all, coming up quick, December 1st. Mm-hmm. Jules? The 30 days of Pittsmas, it's going to be
yep.
30 days of Brad Pitt. Mm-hmm. Did you know he did a lot of TV? And he did 2-second performances in the background of lots of movies. Is that the best song you've ever heard in your life?
It absolutely is a song that I've heard in my life.
I think that was
nice. So there's 30 days of...
Yeah, just Brad Pitt.
Yeah.
Tons of Brad Pitt.
A lot of Brad Pitt.
Hunk. No Way Out.
Mm-hmm.
Less Than Zero. No Man's Land.
Yeah.
Like 8 TV shows. And then
yeah.
A Stoning in Fulham County.
Fucking A.
Fuck.
Amish.
And it just keeps going.
Yeah.
And where does it end?
Fight Club.
I don't think we get Fight Club.
Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
No, we definitely don't get Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Well, you're going to get 7. You're going to get 12 Monkeys.
It
you're going to get Thelma and Louise. You're going to get Cool World.
Around
Johnny Suede.
Yes.
Cutting Class, which I'm excited about.
It ends.
Is it Benjamin Button? Is it around there?
I think it's around.
Oh, it's 7. The Mexican. I think it might be the Mexican.
It might be the Mexican, yeah.
Yeah, we quit around the Mexican.
Mm-hmm.
So 30 Days of Pitt. That's fucking rocking. Tell your friends. This mm-hmm. is what you should be talking about.
Yeah.
We're stupid, but can you believe this? Every fucking day you get a new Brad Pitt? That's right. Yeah. I don't know if we made that clear. Every day there's
every
a new
day.
Episode of Brad Pitt.
Every day you wake up.
Do you know how hard we worked to get this off the ground? We could have been backlogging episodes like a motherfucker. Nah, 30 Days of Pitt. I'm going to piss myself right now.
Arrivederci, baby.